Whew, it feels good to be out of that case. Whew. So this is the future. Looks the same. Hey, you even got that little teddy bear back there thing. That's pretty cool. Hey, Mike, how you doing? So. Oh, fantastic. And I always will keep telling myself that. Well, I got from here, Mike. Oh, man, you just need a lighter? Oh, here, dude, take mine. Here. No, man, don't worry about it. I got, like, two of them. Don't worry about it. Now you got it. Did you quit smoking? I didn't think it would work. Oh, well, it was worth a shot. If I might make a brief announcement. If you are prone to motion sickness or you have a visual impairment, this video might not be for you. The rest of you, if you would, please, get up and move your chairs into the center of the room. You want to be lined up with the screen as best as you can, okay? That's the trick. Everybody just kind of get your screen together. Psst, Mike. Mike. I held up my end of the bargain. I made the video. Where's the paper? And what'd you expect me to do? Just stand up here all freaking day long and talk about absolutely nothing? Thank you. Okay, the video is going to begin in about 5, 4, 3, 2.
This is one pick that. First, I gotta explain myself. You're hearing my voice, a sound wave traveling through the air. What you're hearing looks like this. The ear serves as a transducer, converting sound energy into nerve impulse. The middle ear channels sound waves into the eardrum. The eardrum will set the hammer, anvil, and stirrup into motion at the same frequency as the sound wave. Vibration continues into the consular, the semicircular canal. The canal is the part that's filled with fluid and controls your balance and all that jazz. The consular is lined with over 20,000 hair-like nerve cells, which perform one of the most critical roles in our ability to hear. As the wave moves into the consular, the small hair-like nerve cells will be set into motion. Each hair cell has a natural sensitivity to a particular frequency of vibration. When the frequency of sound matches the natural frequency of the nerve cell will resonate with a larger amplitude of vibration. You follow me on this? The increased vibration amplitude induces the cell to release an electronic impulse, which passes along the auditory nerve into the brain, of course passing into the temporal lobes. And there it's processed into language, music, or just background noise. Visible light enters the eye through the lens, where it's focused onto the retina. Major misconceptions about the retina is that the rods and the cones are spread out over the back of the eye. This is false. The light is only onto one tiny brain center that processes information before sending it down the optic nerve. In fact, the optic nerve is actually part of the brain, and it's been proven that it grows out of the brain during the embryonic development. The part where the light is focused is called the fovea. The rest of the eye is pretty much covered with rods. The rods are not the most detailed receptors, and they're extremely sensitive to light, though. Even a single photon absorbed by one cluster of rods is enough to send a message to the brain. The problem with rods is that most of them share the same path back to the optic nerve. So even if there is a signal, the brain doesn't know where it came from. This explains why you see stuff in the dark. And also why you have images get burned into your brain, or your eyeball, which is why Poggendorf stuff works. Check this out. See little dots? Yeah, they're not actually there. That's your eyeball. Anyway, moving back on. Talking about the cones. The cones are the very light-sensitive part that we're responsible for our sharp images and our brilliant colors. There's almost 3 million cones residing inside the retina. Actually, it's inside the fovea. So, the sharpest, most colorful images are directly in front of us because that's where the lens focuses light. It's important to realize that the eyeball is actually the part that's processing what you're seeing. And then it's sent off to the optic nerve. Your eyes actually think for you. This is evident through several basic visual illusions, such as subjective contours, where here you see all these lines because your eye perceives it as perspective, where all the points come together, like you're looking down a road. It tends to bow out the images on the side, when in fact both of those lines are straight. Also here on Harrington's illusion, you see kind of like those little white dots we were talking about earlier. On Poggendorf's illusion, you can see how your brain sees the blue line there and it tries to kind of piece it back together or make it one straight image, when in fact it's actually kind of off a little bit. This has got to be one of my favoriteest illusions. Alright, you'll see that the two lines appear to be different sizes. One seems to be a little bit bigger than the other. Okay, but as we add the other lines in there, we start to realize that they are the same size. Now, take a look at this picture here. Stare at that little blue dot really intently. Look straight at the blue dot. Now what's going to happen is the green is going to slowly take over the blue dot and it'll eventually disappear. The reason why is because you've got more green receptors in the back of your eye than you do red. And you also have more red receptors in the back of your eye than you do blue. So eventually the green will start to pick up more than the blue will. Okay, enough about the cones. The rod's the part of the brain that I really want to focus on. Alright. Check this image out. Alright, it's not moving, it's a still image. Now, I want you to stare deeply into this spiral. I'm going to stop talking for a minute, but just keep staring into the spiral. In a minute, I'm going to show you that picture again. Keep staring into the spiral. Now, we're touching perception, basically. By now you notice that they're both the same picture, of course, but you're looking at it from a different light because you're applying a different thought process to it. Now, quite frankly, this is beyond my paper, so I'm going to get back to the simple stuff. Okay, so let's take everything that we learned here and ball it all up real quick. Alright, stare deeply at this image. Alright, try to ignore the numbers and look only at the blue dot. Just stare deeply into that blue dot. Try not to look at the numbers, just the blue dot. Think about, what time did you wake up this morning? And keep staring just at the blue dot. Don't focus on the numbers, just stare at the blue dot. And what time did you wake up this morning?